Greetings, I'm Jae Hee Kim, the executive producer of Black Desert. Adventurers, thank you so much for your patience. We are finally ready to unveil the Land of the Morning Light. We would like to thank our global adventurers who have been waiting a long time for this, although we were eager to show you sooner. We decided to focus more on localization for good quality. We hope you enjoy the Land of the Morning Light, since many adventurers were looking forward to this expansion. We have given our best effort, knowing how much it meant to our players. Now let us introduce the Land of the Morning Light, a new challenge and adventurer in the world of Black Desert. Trying something new is always exciting and somewhat daunting. However, rather than focusing on the meaning of success or failure, we believe that the significance lies in the challenge and the attempt itself, as it paves the way for progress. In the Land of Morning Light, we have taken on several new challenges. The first challenge is to move away from the Tolkienish fantasy backgrounds and introduce a concept inspired by Korea's Joseon era, which may feel unfamiliar to our global adventurers, but will offer a fresh visual experience even for Korean adventurers in their 20s who haven't seen it before. However, on the contrary, I have thought about it differently. If it feels new to Korean adventurers, then it could truly be a world of fantasy, unlike anything overseas adventurers have never seen. I wanted adventurers to experience the Korean medieval era, its architecture, clothing, mythology, and joys and sorrows of life. That would be unfamiliar, but still quite relatable. At first, we were also concerned that the unfamiliar images may be too disorienting, but after developing and experiencing it firsthand, we realized that we have made the right decision. We made every effort to capture the beauty of both the Joseon era and of Black Desert. The second challenge was a bold departure from the existing playstyle. We believe that Black Desert has, through time and numerous updates, established a solid basic system of gameplay. And of course, there will always be fine-tuning to be done. Many players have enjoyed the action style and command-based skills of Black Desert, and defeating monsters based on those elements added to the enjoyment of the gameplay. However, no matter how good something is, if you keep encountering it, you start to become too accustomed to that consistent style of gameplay. We needed a change and made various attempts. We tried to create a desert of harsh environmental extremes, an ocean with seemingly no end, Karma Sylvia, where you can feel the foundation of growth and a fantasy atmosphere, Dregan with its highlands and dragon legends, Hadoom with its twist on standard gameplay, and the cutscenes and storytelling of the Mountain of Eternal Winter. We realized that while we should borrow from each of their good aspects, there is a need to fill in the gaps and make even greater changes. We felt that new adventures in a new region should not be the same as existing regions. Therefore, in the Land of the Morning Light, we removed the repetitive mob grinding gameplay. Even from the perspective of the Black Desert development team, it was a daunting challenge. However, we rose to the challenge. In the Land of the Morning Light, the basic gameplay revolves around defeating each boss. The ability for players to set the difficulty of a boss was the very definition of that challenge. The third challenge was to transition from our previous linear quest progression to an omnibus-style one. Adventurers will experience gameplay in the order they choose, based on the storylines they select in Dalbol Village. This allows them to focus on each individual story. Each story, including the Balinus reboot and the Mountain of Eternal Winter that were already introduced, as well as improved cutscenes and storytelling in Abyss the Magnus, will convey various emotions to the adventurers. You'll be able to enjoy each story with a sense of immersion, similar to reading a fairy tale or novel. Please look forward to what new stories await in the Land of the Morning Light. With its new adventures, the Land of the Morning Light is a new challenge in Black Desert. New attempts can be both exciting and daunting. Could have walked the proven path by simply adding new monster zones and bosses. However, we wanted to offer adventurers a slightly different experience here in the Land of the Morning Light. While Black Desert provides a reliable play pattern, we also want players to feel like they can embark on a new adventure at any time. We look forward to the stories you create for yourselves in the new region, the Land of the Morning Light, opening June 14th.
About 100 years ago, a German missionary depicted their impression of Korea's capital. We wondered how we could effectively convey this impression to our adventurers through the game and kept this in mind as we developed the background for the Morning Light. To create a captivating impression of the Land of the Morning Light, the territory beyond Mogoria, we drew inspiration from the stunning natural beauty of Gogom Island in Jeollabuk, Gwangju County. Then, we drew inspiration from the lush and towering bamboo forest of Damyang, which helped bring to life the tranquility and freshness of Simnidae Forest, awash in greens and blues, Dale Pier reflecting the warmth of the new year with its vibrant rose bay paths, Bombawi Valley showcases the majestic silhouette of Taebaek Mountain and the diverse colors of the changing seasons. And Byokge Island displays its serene but restrained beauty like a delicate drop of ink on a white hanji canvas. By carefully incorporating these vibrant colors and natural elements of Korea, we meticulously crafted the terrain of the Land of the Morning Light. We believe that adventurers exploring this new continent will experience both a sense of familiarity and foreignness as if wandering through a beautiful yet undiscovered corner of our country. We also created new terrain that tie in with unique characters from Korean folklore such as Hunbu, Nolbu, Gumyo, and the Dokkaebi. We were fortunate to have received assistance from the Cultural Heritage Administration when designing the pottery and ceramics as well. We also created spaces within the Land of the Morning Light where adventurers could vividly experience the traditional Korean folktales during their travels. We designed these various folktale-inspired environments to reflect the motives and atmosphere unique to our culture. We integrated motifs such as imprisonment and corporal punishment to create an atmosphere reminiscent of visiting the Korean Minsok village. We've incorporated several picturesque and serene spots throughout Black Desert that are perfect for avid adventurers looking to capture memorable moments. Explore the captivating landscapes of Goan Plateau and Bombawi, the Royal Azalea Park, and witness the blossoming Mugunghwa to truly immerse yourself in Korea's traditional beauty. We hope these elements will transport you to the nostalgic ambience of rural Korea, and that you'll revel in the constant adventure, beauty, and wonder that awaits at every corner.
Bosses in the Morning Light were created using various references to Korean folklore and legend, such as the spinster ghost Songgakshi, the tale of Princess Bari, from Jeju Island's Jingukte folklore and the legends of the Golden Pig. We also depicted the Korean Dokkaebi in various forms. They are said to have a human-like appearance and have the ability to inhabit everyday objects, which we brought to life by designing them as sieves or potlets. In addition, some elements which already existed in Black Desert were transformed into their Korean counterparts. The Korean versions of the Papuan otters are from the folktale The Hare's Liver, and the Mudang Wraith was created by imagining Hexe Marie as a mythical Korean creature. Following The Hare's Liver, the characters were originally intended to be designed as tortoises, but due to their potentially intimidating appearance, we depicted them as turtles instead. To draw more representation from Korean culture, the boss Sangun was modeled after the traditional Korean tiger from Korean folktales rather than a typical tiger. Additionally, the illustrations, which play a supporting role in various stories, were designed to look like traditional ink paintings reminiscent of traditional Korean fairy tale books. As we searched for ways to make the commonest clothes more interesting, we found ourselves inspired by the vibrant colors and intricate patterns of traditional Korean embroidery. By incorporating such elements into the design of their clothing, we were able to create a visually stunning and culturally authentic representation of their attire.
We wanted new NPC animations in the Morning Light to be natural and realistically depict the lifestyle of the Joseon era. You'll find old men smoking pipes, laborers weaving reeds, and drunks stumbling around, to children asking neighbors for salt or playing games like Jeggy and Tuhol. We included every possible detail to immerse players in a truly authentic experience that captures the essence of the past. Bosses such as Gumiho, the Dokkaebi King, and Sangun are legends that were designed to show their movements and behavior come to life. We gave careful thought on how to portray the Mudang Wraith. And by designing her to resemble someone who's received a divine revelation and cast spells with that power, we were able to create a character unlike any other.
You all probably encountered Yeonhwa in the pre-quest updated last week. As your companion, who experienced life and death with you in the Magnus, returns to her hometown, I believe your hearts must have been touched by the scene where she invites you. Yeonhwa longed to return to her hometown so badly. The distant and mysterious land of the morning light will welcome our adventurers with refreshing sunlight on June 14th. Global adventurers, you must have grown up listening to interesting tales of the past from your grandparents. Korea also has many such fascinating stories. Since these stories are not yet well known in other countries, they may be somewhat unfamiliar to you, but that just means these fresh and exciting stories are bound to surprise you. These stories have been passed down orally for generations because they're such gripping tales. We have chosen the most relatable themes, such as the love of parents or long-hidden love, and we've adapted them so global adventurers can easily understand them. With over 80 story cutscenes, more than 40 vignettes, and over 6,000 fully dubbed lines, we know you'll be fully immersed. On June 14th, you will receive an invitation from Yeonhwa and arrive at Nampo Harbor in the Land of the Morning Light. Yeonhwa is busy and leaves you in the care of Dorsue, who will accompany you on this adventure in the new land. From day one with Dorsue, you will be dragged into mysterious incidents. You will be unjustly accused and even imprisoned. Through your adventure, you must uncover the truth of these events and find out who the culprit is. Oh, and the fate of certain bosses in the Land of the Morning Light may vary depending on your choices. Listen and read the story carefully, and choose the path your heart tells you to follow. Then, your own collection of tales will be written as you go along.
The boss battle scenes in both the Mountain of Eternal Winter and the Balanos reboot began with a dark screen that brightened to reveal the boss being summoned before the start of the battle. Some adventurers felt this transition was a bit abrupt and disconnected. We put a lot of thought into how we could make these boss battles a more seamless experience, and we've implemented a new system where we've allowed boss battles to begin in the middle of cutscenes to avoid disrupting the flow of the story. We also developed many new mechanics for the bosses which appear in cutscenes and paid attention to details like camera focus and character expressions that were previously lacking.
This time we have tried a new combat style in the Land of the Morning Light. There are no typical monster zones, but instead the region consists solely of boss encounters. It's called the Black Desert Boss Blitz. In the Land of the Morning Light, instead of monster zones, there will be 8 bosses, each with their own story and traits. The 8 bosses include the enchanting fox spirit Gumiho, the Bamboo Legion from Korean folklore, the Changi, evil spirits of those who died from a tiger attack, the powerful Mudang Wraith, the Songgakshi, also known as the Spinster Ghost, the mischievous Golden Pig King, the King of Tokkebi, Tuokshini, and the Tiger King, Sanggun, who is terrorizing the Land of the Morning Light. Each of these bosses has their own story and distinct characteristics. As adventurers, you can gradually conquer these challenges by learning their traits and patterns. Today, I would like to focus on one particular boss, the Golden Pig King. With a massive sword befitting his size, he exhibits intimidating attacks that resembles an executioner. He has an audacious personality, so he shouts how cowardly it is for you to keep running away. Another boss that stands out is the Songgakshi, one of the most famous ghosts in Korea. The Songgakshi is the spirit of an unmarried woman that died in an unexpected accident. With long hair covering her face and wearing a white funeral robe, the Songgakshi is synonymous with horror. The story of how she became a spirit is a tragic one. Each boss is unique in terms of their appearance, personality, and combat style. I hope all adventurers enjoy the diverse experiences they provide. By playing through the main quest and learning the background stories, you can immerse yourself more in the battles with these bosses. Therefore, I recommend enjoying the main quest before facing them. That's not everything. Since all these bosses are released in Korea, those who've been keeping up with the game might feel a bit less excited about the content for its global release. That's why we added one more boss, specifically for the global update, the monster Imugi. Imugi will be released for the first time to all our global adventurers. I hope you'll enjoy this fresh and new experience.
The difficulty of boss battles are divided into 10 levels, ranging from Calamity Level 1, the lowest, to Calamity Level 10, the highest. Initially, you'll be able to conquer the lower levels without much difficulty, but as you progress, new attack patterns will emerge, creating more intense challenges. Therefore, if you are not familiar with boss battles or find them too difficult, it's okay to start from a lower level and gradually work your way up. Each of the bosses in the Land of the Morning Light possesses one of three attributes: Sun, Moon, or Earth. These attributes affect the boss's AP and DP. Therefore, it will be difficult for you to defeat the bosses effectively as soon as the Land of the Morning Light is released. During your adventure in the Land of the Morning Light, you will obtain a special item called the Light Orb in limited quantities. Light Orbs are like points that allow you to enhance the Sun, Moon, or Earth attributes. For example, by investing 3 Light Orbs into the Earth attribute, Earth AP and DP will increase. This will allow you to deal more damage to the bosses and reduce the damage received. Additionally, all the bosses in this update have their own weaknesses, represented by the Sun, Moon, and Earth attributes. If you invest heavily in the Earth attribute, you'll have a huge advantage against bosses like Sangun or Gumiho, who are weak against Earth. The number of Light Orbs you can obtain is limited. As adventurers, you can strategically invest your points, designate the boss difficulty, and make your own builds.
90% of the damage dealt to the bosses in the Land of the Morning Light is from your attribute AP, and 10% from your character's AP. The DP ratio is also set the same way. With these ratios, it enables adventurers just starting out to face these bosses after they play through the Land of the Morning Light. We believe that we need to continue thinking about accessibility for more people with new content, like the Arena of Solaire. And as a result of this consideration, we have decided to implement attribute AP and DP. We may make changes to it over time, but our goal is to make it accessible, so we'd like to ask our veteran adventurers for their understanding.
Let's move on to new loot and items. I'm certain that many of you are brimming with anticipation, but first, I'd like to reveal the subjugation rankings that is part of this update. The subjugation ranking shows how fast you cleared each boss by difficulty level, but unlike the existing ranking system, this one will be applied to each class individually rather than collectively. The difficulties of each boss won't be fully available at first, but they'll gradually unlock as each class successfully subjugate the previous difficulty. For example, if you are playing Warrior, an adventurer must initially clear a specific difficulty as a Warrior in order to unlock the next difficulty level for all other Warriors. As each class in Black Desert possesses their own set of unique abilities and combat style, strategizing a plan may be more or less challenging, depending on the characteristics of the boss and that particular class. In the end, we adopted this approach to give skilled adventurers who have extensively studied and gained experience with a particular class the opportunity to achieve greater glory. We hope that this opens up more challenging opportunities for adventurers. Alright, let's move on to loot and new items that can be obtained from these bosses. Allow me to introduce the new accessory, Belt of Tepic, which comes with a special option that activates new skills immediately upon equipping it. The belt grants the Blessing of Tepic skill, and activates a protective buff for you and your nearby allies. But it's important to note that it has a relatively long cooldown, and as you defeat these bosses, there is a small yet certain probability that you'll obtain special loot called the Jewel of Illusion. You can also bring the jewel back to the main continent, where it can be crafted into accessories. Next up is the Deboreka earring that many have been eagerly anticipating. The Deboreka earring not only possesses its own inherent attributes, but also plays a role in activating the Deboreka 3 set effect, so many adventurers would be excited to hear this news. Furthermore, new crystals will be added. Adventurers can unlock 2 additional crystal slots as they venture through the Land of the Morning Light. You'll be able to equip existing crystals or the new Morning Light crystals in these slots. Various crystals with diverse effects will be added, including the previously introduced Bongwang's Tear. Additionally, new materials for upgrading the combined magic crystals will be introduced, allowing for even more versatile builds.
Last but not least, we have the new, highly anticipated gear, Dan's Gloves. The gloves comes in two versions, damage reduction and evasion. You'll initially craft one version of the gloves, then have the option to exchange them for the other. We put a lot of thought into their crafting method, as there are no new monster zones. We explored different ways of crafting to make it engaging and avoid repetitiveness. Therefore, we made the gloves a loot drop for defeating the bosses in the Land of the Morning Light. However, the chance of obtaining them as loot is very low. Additionally, a new material called Flame of Hongi, similar to the Flame of Despair and Flame of Frost, is required to craft the gloves. The materials for Flame of Hongi can be obtained through defeating bosses, as well as by collecting Crystallized Despair in the Elvia Kelfion. Dan's gloves were crafted with a motif of the gloves worn by King Taejo of Joseon, Yi Seong-ge, one of the greatest archers in the history of Korea. Therefore, their appearance reflects its significance. Also, mark your calendars for the upcoming Kafras Extraction event, which will start at the launch of the Land of the Morning Light.
Now let's shift our focus to residences. In the Land of the Morning Light, there aren't any residences like the ones you're used to. Instead, there are two manors which closely resemble the blue-maned lion's manor. One is very spacious, with room for lots of decorations, while the other has a more compact design. This is the Shimyangje, a unique residential area in the Land of the Morning Light, based on the traditional Korean Hanok tile-roofed Kiwa house. The name Shimyangje means the home in one's heart, and it indeed brings peace to one's heart and mind. You'll be enchanted by the courtyard's fragrant flowers in spring, while the sound of raindrops falling on the eaves will soothe the summer's heat. In autumn, you can immerse yourself in the tranquil sunset with a good book. Finally, during winter, snuggle up in the guest house with your beloved pets as you watch the snow fall outside. Don't you feel at peace just imagining it? You can also explore the interior of the Shimyangje at the end of the main questline in Land of the Morning Light. New and unique furniture will be added, designed especially for the Land of the Morning Light. These furniture pieces were designed to complement the unique manners of the region, but they're also stunning enough to enhance any other existing space. They will be exquisite additions to your blue-maned manor in Serendia. You'll also be able to construct a new ship, the Panokson. The Panokson may appear to be primarily used for combat, as evident from its exterior design, but its true charm lies in the flexibility of the ship's performance, as it is able to hold quite a large crew. In other words, while the overall performance of the ship may be lower than that of the existing Carrick, it can be customized and prepared for different purposes by adjusting the number of crew members or assigning certain equipment. The Panokson can be constructed using crafting materials from the Land of the Morning Light and sea coins. To build the Panokson, you will need sea coins, which means construction will be easier for those who already possess a Carrick. However, it's important to note that the ship's construction period is intentionally designed to require consistent effort and dedication in order to complete the process.
Finally, let's talk about the changes to life skills. In the Land of the Morning Light, you can embark on adventures which are centered around life skills. During this process, you can acquire the Green Thumb knowledge, and once you learn this knowledge, you'll obtain a new skill called Green Artisan. This gives you the chance to activate a new minigame when you gather after learning this skill. The minigames activate through various gathering activities such as lumbering, fluid gathering, hoeing, butchering, mining, and tanning. And it was designed with simple controls. You'll use more energy to clear the minigame, but you can get a lot of gathering materials, which overall allows you to significantly reduce the time required compared to traditional gathering methods. Additionally, there's an extremely rare item that can only be obtained in these minigames, introducing the Millennial Wild Ginseng. In the Morning Light, this herb is highly valued, surpassing any treasures of gold or silver. When used, it provides a unique buff to your character that lasts for approximately 3 months. You can gather and use it yourself, or trade it on the central market at a high price. you could see it as a jackpot drop for the gathering content.
New herbal medicine and food items have been added as well. You'll be able to use them separately from cron meals, elixirs, and perfumes. As they have powerful effects, they are designed only to be used at crucial moments. For example, although they have a cooldown of 22 hours, there's food which restores your HP by 5,000 and an herbal medicine that restores energy by 500 and then gives 30 energy recovery for an hour. Oh, and how can we forget about gukbap? We've added a perfect pairing for gukbap. It's a small change, but exotic herbal wine, which will now be called makgeolli, will be available as well. Next, let's talk about life crystals. With a wider variety of crystal types available, you can now use crystal presets for various setups. These life crystals can be obtained through quests or crafted using different materials. Additionally, you can acquire a little tokkebi worker in the Land of the Morning Light. This tokkebi can work at regular production nodes and also be sent to the special exclusive crafting house to create unique items. You'll also encounter thrilling surprises with the swing of the magical gebi bat, so we hope everyone gives it a try.
Lastly, we will be discussing news about Marnie, whose reach has already extended to the Land of the Morning Light. Apparently, he's come up with another invention called Marnie's Sniper Rifle. As expected from Marnie, it's not only well-crafted, but also exquisite in appearance. With the addition of Marnie's Sniper Rifle, we made updates to sniper rifle hunting as well. The most notable addition is targetable monster parts. The amount of damage dealt will vary depending on the parts hit, and the overall result will determine the tier of the reward. Headshots will guarantee the highest possible damage, though rewards will vary by the type of monster hunted. Also, when you use Marnie's Sniper Rifle, a UI will display which part of the monster your shot landed on. We hope that this new sniper rifle is exciting news for those who have been enjoying sniper rifle hunting. Hello, I am Ryu Hyuman, the music director of the audio department. The composers of Pearl Abyss, responsible for the fantastic Everfrost soundtrack, returned for this project, each representing their unique style of traditional Korean music. I, too, have composed a piece of music in the traditional style. The goal of this music project was to showcase how fascinating traditional Korean music can be as a genre. In my case, I focused on the rhythm of traditional Korean music, as well as its instruments, samulnori, and shamanic music. The rhythms were incredibly profound, and I became immersed in the world of this music, and lost track of time working on this project. While producing the music for The Morning Light, I used an experimental piece inspired by samulnori rhythm for the battle between Wusa and Megu. I had not expected adventurers to enjoy it so much, and it gave me the courage to attempt more diverse and beautiful traditional rhythms for this expansion. To enhance the intensity of combat, I studied the characteristics of each boss and composed traditional Korean music that fit well with them. For the boss Mudang Wraith, I rearranged the rhythm of Gyeonggi Dodang Gut, which was music used in shamanic rituals during the Joseon Dynasty. I also created a motif from the dynamic and complex rhythm of two of the most prominent rhythms in samulnori music. Including these battle music pieces, The Morning Light's audio theme consists of five different genres: meditation music to soothe the mind, emotional music to accompany the story, village music to suit the ambience when strolling around, and horror music for eerie situations and environments. We plan to showcase a variety of traditional Korean music pieces in the future, starting with The Morning Light. We hope you enjoy listening to them.
Lastly, we'd like to point out the amount of effort poured into localizing the Land of the Morning Light. As this content is rooted in Korean culture, it is bound to feel unfamiliar for our global adventurers. With this in mind, we endeavor to accurately convey the subtle connotations and contexts of these innately Korean stories. The voice actors paid extra careful attention to each and every word to capture their essence. Also, certain parts were not translated to maintain the impression of entering a foreign country. For example, signs on buildings and the marketplace bulletins are written in Hangul, the Korean alphabet. We believe this will create the immersive experience of stepping foot into a new world. This concludes our intro to the Land of the Morning Light. I remember when we first began this project. It was both exciting and nerve-wracking, and to think that we are now launching this globally after our initial launch in Korea is a euphoric feeling. I don't think I've ever been this nervous when introducing new content. When preparing the image representative of the Land of the Morning Light, we captured the back of a warrior wearing medieval armor as he steps onto its streets. We believe this image conveyed the sense of a stranger in unfamiliar land, arousing curiosity and a sense of adventure. We believe that the image will accurately reflect the sentiment of our adventurers right now. We hope you enjoy your adventures in the Land of the Morning Light.
We have news on Wusa's Awakening, which I'm sure many of our adventurers are all waiting for. After witnessing the love and support for Wusa and Megu, we wanted to create something even better. We have kept some of their original animations intact, but we have also made some significant changes. As such, their update schedule was inevitably pushed back. While developing Awakening Wusa, we put a lot of thought into how to bring a uniqueness to the character. We then came across a search on Flower Garden, one of the folk tales in Korea, and decided it would be a fitting motive. This motive was manifested and implemented into Awakening Wusa. The Sochon Flower Garden is one of the places in the afterlife where the souls of the dead gather. At first, we worried that this would be difficult to convey. We incorporated the unnamed flowers and spirits of Netherworld, along with the moon of the night sky that Wusa came to represent the afterworld. Luckily, the result was more impressive than we'd initially imagined. Like this, Awakening Wusa gained a new sense of individuality. We will continue our introduction with a video we prepared of Awakening Wusa.
Hyun, the more you try to erase your bloodlines, the clearer they become. And the more you try to forget them, the greater your longing grows.
Eun, though you walk down different paths, your fate, preordained by the heavens, will lead you both to one enlightenment.
Are you ready to face each other?
For those seeing our twin sisters for the first time, let me give you a brief explanation. These sisters are fundamentally rivals to each other. One is affiliated with the Wudo school, and the other, the Jado school. They are like the Jedi and Sith in Star Wars, with different martial arts training methods and conflicting ideologies that set them at odds. You can see the younger sister, Wusa of the Wudo school, as the Jedi, and the older sister, Megu of the Jado school, as the Sith. Last December, we uploaded The Tale of Two Twins to our official Black Desert YouTube. Listening to this audiobook will give you much greater insight into their relationship. As Wusa progresses through her awakening quest, she has a profound realization and encounters a mighty spirit. As a result, she can draw power from the Sochon Flower Garden, a realm of the afterlife in Korean mythology. The bright moon gracefully rising above a pristine puddle, the flowers that bloom in all directions, the spirits that emerge from the book she clasps in her left hand, and the calligraphy she writes with the brush in her right hand. All of these represent the inner nature of Wusa. Wusa has always emphasized the power of humanity. diligently honing her inner self and accumulating knowledge. Due to these principles, she used to criticize her sister Megu for drawing power from external sources such as spirits. Play through Wusa's Awakening quest to discover firsthand what kind of spiritual being Wusa encountered that ultimately led her to acknowledge and accept divine power.
The weapon's appearance will not be a charm, but rather will look much like a book. We believe that if we weave the charms together into the form of a book, the imagery would amplify Wusa's elegant and serene demeanor. For her outfit, our aim was to give Wusa, embodying the essence of the Seocheon flower garden, the allure of an aristocratic figure. We drew inspiration from the attire worn by officials during ancestral rites in the Joseon Dynasty, with the formal attire known as Wonsam, also worn by high-ranking officials, to further enhance our identity as a representative of the Wudo school and a princess. The shoulder piece symbolizes flowers blooming at Gwangcheon Lake, while the lantern adorning her waist conveys the feeling of guiding spirits.
The combat style for Awakening Wusa is a hybrid with a focus on mid-range combat. One of the most distinctive features is the ability for Wusa to wield flowers. These flowers serve as summons that bloom and perform various roles to assist Wusa when she utilizes her skills. Allow me to introduce one of Awakening Wusa's main skills called Moonlit Blast. It is a skill where the flowers summoned around Wusa explode, causing AoE damage. A pond-like water effect spreads across the ground. This symbolizes the boundary between the mortal realm and the afterlife. Moreover, the water is illuminated by the moon, evoking an image of the night sky. This displays how our worlds are intertwined by reflecting the night sky in the afterlife above the Seocheon flower garden. Next, we have a skill that embodies Awakening Wusa's combat style called Floral Burst. Floral Burst creates small seeds in front of Wusa that blossom into flowers after a short duration, dealing significant damage in the area. Next is the skill called Seocheon Field. When used, small flowers bloom at the targeted location. These flowers work like mines. When someone approaches them, they explode to inflict big damage. Between the timed skill and the mind, we can get creative and dominate the battlefield. Planting flowers along the path you anticipate your enemies to follow can create openings for you. You can also confuse your opponents by inflicting damage at unexpected timings while performing regular attacks. The next main skill is Mark of the Moon. This skill is presented with the concept of a flower of the afterlife. When using this skill, it inflicts damage to enemies in front and leaves a mark on a target. Summoned flowers then pursue the marked target to claim its soul, and explode after a certain period to inflict damage. In PvE, it can be utilized as the main damage skill, while in PvP, it can be used to track enemies and deal damage. Also, the Mark of the Moon effect is meant to appear like a record of the ones destined for the underworld. To visually represent this concept, we incorporate hunger into the skill effects. Despite being a formidable skill, we strive to make it elegant with hunger woven into Wusa's unique and graceful movements. I believe explanation alone may not be enough, so we've prepared a combat video. Let's take a look. Thank you.
내게 무익한 요군 처단하라.
그녀는 어린 시절엔 동생과 함께 우도방 소속이었었습니다. 하지만 우도방의 소라 방식에는 별다른 재능이 없었고, 이 때문에 방황을 거듭하다 결국 우도방에 적게 되니 우도방에 들어가게 오히려 이곳에서 재능의 꽃을 피우게 되죠. 이런 그녀가 각성 퀘스트를 진행하게 되면서 내면의 깨달음을 얻고 다시 부채를 손에 쥐게 됩니다. 누구와 만났는지, 어떤 이야기가 펼쳐지는지 You will discover them firsthand by experiencing the awakening quest yourself.
Her awakening weapon is in the final stages of development, so we haven't prepared a full combat video yet. Instead, let me briefly explain the combat style of Awakening Meiku. Unlike Succession Wusa, she wields two fans and focuses more on melee combat, rather than manipulating wind and storm clouds. She is capable of piercing through enemies and creating powerful fiery attacks with the power of the Fox Spirit. Furthermore, by spreading both fans to unleash a burst of flames, she can inflict debuffs in a wide area of effect. While each movement skill may not cover a great distance, she has a variety of them that help her chase down enemies at remarkable speed.
This is the end of our update on Awakening Wusa and Meigu. The development of Awakening Meigu is in its final stages. We are working hard to present to our adventurers a new and enjoyable gameplay. The Awakening Wusa update is scheduled to be released across all regions on May 31st. As for the Awakening Meigu, she is planned to be released in June.
This is all we have prepared for today. From the bottom of our hearts, we thank you all for continuing to enjoy our game. We will continue in striving to bring to you the best adventures possible, and ensure that Black Desert is the most enjoyable as it can be. Thank you.